video, I will share some of my high-paying data engineering freelance projects. Now, these were the projects that made me more than $100,000 in the span of 2 years. I have worked with more than 25 clients around the world and worked on many different types of projects, building an ETL pipeline, just consulting, architecture system, and all of the other things. But these were the high-paying projects that I learned a lot and also made a lot of money. So I just want to discuss about some of the architecture diagram, what types of projects that I've done. I mainly worked on AWS and GCP side of the thing, so I will try to explain you all of these projects and just give you the overview of what type of things we were dealing with and what we actually did in that project. Now, before we move forward, I want to talk about our today's sponsor, Project Pro. Now, Project Pro is a curated library of different hands-on projects in the space of big data, data engineering, data science, and machine learning. One of the best ways you can learn new technologies is by building projects. Now, I have few projects available on my YouTube channel, but if you want to get the exposure to more projects, you can definitely check out Project Pro. They have more than 250 end-to-end projects available on their website. These projects are built by some of the experts who worked in Amazon, Google, Microsoft, and all of those big companies. So you should definitely check out Project Pro. You will get a lot of different resources on how to execute data engineering projects end-to-end. And some of the projects that we will talk in this video, you can also get the similar type of architecture project on their website also. So I will definitely recommend you to check out projectpro.io. You will find the link in the description, and let's continue with our video. Now, this was the first project that I have done. This was on the AWS cloud, and I worked with the two people with this project. The two people were from the client's team, and I was helping them to integrate all of these technologies together. So what they really had is that they had some external sources data. Those were coming from the third party, such as web analytics and some of the APIs of their vendors. And then they had some data on the on-premise data center because they did not move to the cloud. This was a project where they decided that we want to go from on-premise data center and we want to take our entire data infrastructure onto the cloud network. So this is how we started. Okay, the first step we did in this is that get all of the data from these multiple sources at one location. And our one location was this Amazon S3, which is an object storage. So what we really did is that if you want to create the connection between on-premise network to the S3 bucket, you can order something called as an AWS Direct Connect. It's kind of like the physical link between your data center and the AWS. So the data transfer rate is much more faster than the internet. So you get the dedicated connection from AWS where you can transfer data from your on-premise network to the AWS in much faster way than the internet. Okay, so this is the first thing that you can order from the AWS website itself. You just have to click on the order just like you do it on the Amazon website when you buy a product. So you can do that. And then other thing, the third party APIs, we had to integrate with the different vendors and pull those data onto the S3 bucket. So this is the first step, and this takes a lot of time because it's not something you just make the connection and start getting the data. You have to make strategies around that, is that what type of data we are actually targeting, how can we integrate all of these data, how will we store all of these data onto the S3 bucket. Basically, you have to create the right folders, how the new data will come, what will happen once we transform all of these data. So all of these different strategies takes time. It is not something that you do it in 1 to 2 days. It takes weeks of effort to build those entire strategy, from naming convention to making sure the backups and all of the other things. Okay, so this is the first step, and this is what the general case happens in the projects where companies are trying to move from the on-premise network to the cloud network. After that, we had like very simple architecture that we got the data. What we really want to do in this project is that we want to just understand how we can move our data infrastructure onto the cloud network. So AWS have this service called as AWS Glue. This is the ETL service provided by AWS. So what it really does is that once we have our raw data, we write some logic in Spark code or Python code as per the requirement, and then we transform this data and put this data back onto the AWS bucket. So over here we have the raw data, and over here we have the harmonized or the transformed data. So this is the ETL part of our pipeline. When we got the raw data, we understood that, okay, this is the raw data we have, these many files we have, these were the columns that we are actually targeting, and based on that we write our code or logic on AWS Glue. I have a dedicated project on my channel, YouTube Data Analytics, which has the similar kind of architecture. So if you want to understand how to build that, you can definitely check out. I'll put the link in the description. So once we have our transformed data, which is the harmonized data, what we really want to do, we want to find the value from all of these data. Now, one path is you can go with the data warehouse, where you can build the data warehouse properly, data warehouse using Amazon Redshift. And then second path is you can do the ad hoc query analysis. So Amazon RedShift is a data warehouse service provided by AWS. Where you want to run the analytics query, you can easily do that. I was working on this project around 2020 or 2021, and that time we did not have the Redshift serverless. What we really had is that when you want to create the Redshift environment, you have to create the cluster and you have to manage some part of it. So you pay based on the amount, like if you run the cluster for 24 hours, you will have to pay for that much amount. So it was quite expensive. So what we did is that we also created the second pipeline. It's kind of like the glue crawler. What it does, it goes onto this S3 file. Okay, it extracts the schema and you can directly write SQL query on top of the file. So you don't have to store your data onto the Redshift. What you can do, you can keep your data onto Amazon S3 as it is, and you can directly write SQL queries using Amazon Athena, which is like the ad hoc query interface. So you can directly write the SQL queries on top of the existing files and get the valuable insights. So this is like the very basic architecture diagram, but the problem and the complications were in this project was the amount of data that we had and the types of data that we had to deal with. So most of the time it took is this part, okay, making the connection and storing the right data. Once you have the right data in place, writing the transformation block is way easier and storing that data. So the biggest challenge in this project was prepared the ingestion part, and all of the other things were quite easy. Now this is the second project that I worked on, which was data lake on AWS. Okay, in this we had the similar use case. Client had the data onto on-premise network and they wanted to migrate to AWS and see how they can take their entire data infrastructure on AWS. Okay, so some of the things they wanted to keep as it is and some of the things they wanted to use from AWS. In this case, as you can see, we have the Tableau and the Alteryx. Alteryx is an ETL tool. So they had existing ETL tool in their on-premise network. So in this case, what they wanted to do, they wanted to take the Alteryx onto the AWS, onto EC2 machine. As you can see, this is the EC2 machine network. They wanted to deploy that and they wanted to keep that. So we designed this entire architecture diagram by keeping that in mind, that we will use some of the AWS services, but we will also use their existing tools and integrate in the architecture. So this might look complicated from the top, but it is quite easy. As you can see, we had like servers, user database, and all of the other things was on the on-premise. What we did is we created the VPN connection. So as you can see, we created the VPN connection. VPN connection is like the virtual private network where you can transfer your data from one source to the another source in a secure manner. So we created the VPN connection. So once the VPN connection is created, all of those important data are being transferred from the secure network. So first is the extraction of the data. And as you can see, we extract the raw data as it is from the location. So we have the databases and data extraction workers. This is kind of like some programs that we were running that stores data onto the AWS raw bucket. After that, they had their own ETL logic already in place onto the Alteryx. Alteryx is an enterprise level tool to build the ETL pipeline. So what we did, we deploy this Alteryx tool onto the EC2 machine, which is kind of like the online computer. So we deployed that and we ran their existing ETL code and stored that data onto the S3 bucket again. So this part, we replicated what they had on their on-premise network as it is. We did not change anything. What we really did is that we just took the on-premise part and moved that onto the cloud network and deployed that onto the cloud architecture by adding the VPC and all of the securities around it. Okay, after we did this, then they had some other logics that they wanted to extract. So this was their current pipeline, but they had the requirement that we want to utilize all of these data and find more insights from it. So either we can go with the Alteryx or we can use the AWS's existing tool, which was AWS Glue. As you can see it over here, the process data comes here, then we use that process data to process it more so that we can find the valuable insight from that. So we use the glue over here, then we again store the data onto the S3 bucket because we want the persistent storage, and then using Athena you can either query your database or you can use a Tableau, because as they had already purchased the license for the Tableau, we deployed the Tableau tool onto the EC2 machine so that we can visualize all of our data. One of the most important steps in this project is to make sure all of these things happen in very secure manner and it actually replicates what they have on their on-premise network and gives the better performance. So we had to keep all of these things in the mind. As you can see, there are some other services on the side, which is like the KMS to encrypt some of the data, SNS for based on the notification, config rule, cloud watch for the logs, Lambda, CloudTrail, IAM, organization. So it is not something just building a pipeline. You have to take care of all of the other things such as security, governance side, making sure you can audit the logs and how you handle the errors. This project took around 1 year. It was not something we completed in like 2 to 3 months. It takes months and months of effort to build all of this project. Now, then we have this project, which is like the ML on AWS. This is kind of like the similar project that we did, but this was more towards the machine learning side of the things. The entire data infrastructure was on AWS itself, but they wanted to write the machine learning model. So I got a chance to work on this project. As a freelancer, you get to work on multiple things. So this was my opportunity to work on this project. Now, as you can see, they had the data existing on the AWS Redshift. Okay. And then they had their own data engineers team who worked on the extraction of the data. We had the data onto Redshift. What we did is first we extract the data onto the raw bucket as it is. We do not change anything. First thing always is that you get your data onto the some centralized location. So S3 is your centralized location where you get the raw data as it is. As we extracted this data from the Redshift, that means our data was in already structured format. So we did not have to do more processing. The processing that is required is from the machine learning side, which is kind of like the feature engineering, making sure the data types is right, or the choosing columns that are required for machine learning models and all of the other things. So this is being done onto the AWS SageMaker using the Jupyter Notebook. We had to read all of these raw data, do some basic processing and store that onto the process bucket. After that, you can train your machine learning models based on the process data that you have. So you can again store your training data onto the one bucket and keep your evaluation data or the testing data on some other bucket and train your machine learning algorithms based on that. On top of that, we also provided them Athena. So if they want to query their existing data, they can also do that using SQL. And then we integrated the Glue architecture in between so that if they want to write the transformation logic, they can also do that. So this was one of the challenging projects because training machine learning model is not easy. It takes a lot of time. And then this was the project that I worked at the Wayfair. This is a first year project that I worked. It's a project that I worked at Wayfair. Okay. I worked at Wayfair for like 3 years and I got a chance to work on multiple projects. They had the entire infrastructure on GCP. When I joined the company, they were moving from on-premise network to the GCP network. And I had the chance to migrate all of their existing data, SQL scripts and all of the other things onto the GCP, then build their entire data model on GCP BigQuery so that they can analyze all of those data. So I'll explain you again, architecture is somewhat similar. Complexity, as I told you, does not lie over here. The complexity of the data engineering project lies in this case, which is getting the data from the multiple location and building the ingestion engine where you can keep getting the new data as they are coming, but also make sure the processing of the data happens in a proper manner. So as you can see it over here, we have the data coming in the mobile client because people are using the application. Then we have some app stream. Then they have like some other application stream, which is the sensor data. All of these data are getting ingested onto the Kafka. Kafka is the message broker. If you want to process the real-time data streaming, it can do it in a faster rate. They also had the OLTP system design. So they were using MS SQL Server, which was on the on-premise center. What we did is we created the CDC pipeline, change data capture. So whenever any changes happens on the database side, we automatically capture all of those things and directly store it onto the cloud storage, which is kind of like the S3 bucket of the GCP object storage. Once we have, then the challenge becomes much more easier because we got the data onto the right format. We have all of our raw data stored as it is. What we really need to do is write our transformation logic onto the data proc, which is like the Apache Spark environment provided by the Google. And then after that, we can directly store our data onto the BigQuery, which is like the data warehouse service. And also we can run the machine learning models on top of it. So this part is quite easy, but the challenging part was this, which is getting the data from the OLTP. We had like multiple data streams coming and we were directly storing the raw data onto the BigQuery also. So there are two cases. One case is you store onto the Google Cloud Storage where you want to write some transformation block. For data engineers who are mainly working on the transformation side, they can use this data and write the code onto the Spark and create the data warehouse as per the ETL pipeline and the requirement. And then there is one more case where you directly store data as it is from OLTP to BigQuery. So you will get the raw data as it is directly stored onto the data warehouse. And if a data analyst want to have the access to the raw data that they had onto the on-premise system, they can also use that and build their own tables on top of it, which we call as a data mart. So if they want to build a data mart on top of it, on top of this, they can easily do that. So again, this is like the one architecture. They had like 4 to 5 different architecture for different use cases. They had their own internal tools and everything. Can't share all of them, and I've also hidden a lot of different components in this diagram because I had signed NDA, but these are the normal tools that I can show you right now. There are other things that I had to hide it because of the NDA, but I hope you got the idea of the types of projects that you will get to work on. You will get more complicated projects if you work in a product-based company or the consulting-based companies. Depending on the requirement, you will get different types of projects. But I just wanted to give you the overview of the types of projects that you will do in the real world. And this is what I try to share it in my courses also and in my YouTube channel. So if you want to learn all of these things, I create my own courses based on my experiences and what happens in the real world by doing a lot of research. So you should definitely check out my courses if you're interested in that. This was all from this video. If you have worked on any data engineering projects that you want to share, you can share it in the comment section so that people can learn from it. Thank you for watching. If you learned something new, then don't forget to hit the like button. Subscribe to the channel if you are new here. I'll see you in the next video.